Hi everybody, this is Craig Tanner for The Mindful Eye and The Daily Critique. Today's image was created by Harriet, who's a beginning photographer from New York City. Harriet shot this with a Nikon D300, an effective focal length of approximately 160 millimeters. Exposure data we have is f3.2, 1/125th of a second. Harriet says she shot this in Central Park. She was drawn to the form of these plants and also the colors in the scene. That's what I want to start off talking about. Harriet's image gives us a great chance to talk about color theory a little bit today. Colors in this image, to my eye, have a real strong sense of vibrating quite a bit and really moving me around in the image in a very dynamic way. And that's because Harriet, with the colors that she's showing us here, she's implying several different pairs of color opposites or color complements. Color opposites, if we mix them, they'll make gray. True color opposites create a real strong sense in both of the colors that are opposing each other of color vibrancy. Can also really create an emotional feeling and design feeling of depth that's not actually there. It can imply or create an illusion of being able to move into and through the image. We've got implied yellow and blue here. We also have, in a more subtle way, the implication of blue and orange. Yellow and blue from the printer's color wheel, blue and orange from the painter's, yellow and violet from the painter's color wheel, and green and magenta from the printer's color wheel. Just really encourage you to become more conscious in the way that you think about color. And some real basic ways to do that is to just identify the hues of color that you're working with, and then to think about color relationships. Look at your basic color wheels, the painter's color wheel and also the printer's color wheel, and just start to say, okay, these are the colors that I have present in my composition, and here's how they relate to each other. It'd be a great way to start if you're a beginning photographer to just get more conscious of color relationships, because it matters when it comes to design. The other thing that I really enjoy about Harriet's image is the other thing that she mentioned in her backstory. There's a really beautiful sense of these repeating arcs and just real simple, elegant, whimsical qualities of line. Just really enjoying the way those lines are playing out through the image and moving me through the whole composition. It's also a really beautiful juxtaposition of line with these out-of-focus circles of light, the bokeh. It's happening because here it shot at a very shallow depth of field. There's several things that I want to talk about today in terms of maybe things to think about when you're shooting a shot like this that could be helpful, giving yourself some choices in terms of depth of field. So I want to talk about a couple of other things. One goes back to the idea of color, and another has to do with the idea of proportion and framing. Let's talk about technique when you're shooting a shot like this. Harriet's made the decision to focus here, and then these ideas are out of focus, but they're not very far out of focus. One of the things that happens for me is there's quite a bit of tension that's created in the fact that there's a lot of contrast in here, a lot of contrast here. These ideas are almost sharp, but not quite. I have to go quite a long way in the image away from this to get to a point that is sharp. And so one of the things that I might have thought about in this composition is maybe doing something, if the wind's not blowing and I'm on a tripod, doing something that I call a split focus technique, where I actually shoot a variety of frames focusing in different places. Here for a frame, here for a frame, here for a frame. Maybe I shoot one frame where I stop down more and get a little bit more depth of field. And then if the wind's not blowing, if this is in a calm area, then I could play around with layering those images together to maybe bring in a little sharpness here, bring in a little bit here, imply this is on the same plane of focus as this. I might even tilt my camera a little bit to imply that. And that may cut down on some of the tension that a person might feel wanting these ideas and the composition to be sharp. The other thing that you could do if it was very calm is shoot a whole series of shots where you're just changing your focus a little bit. You start in focus here, then focus just a little bit further in, a little bit further in, maybe shoot 10 or 15 frames, and use a piece of software like Helicon Focus, or one of our sponsors, to create more depth of field. You could sandwich all those together and have one frame where there's a lot of depth of field, and then you could layer that in with a shot like this. This definitely is an image that makes me think about split focus. The other thing that you could work with here, if you had it, would be a tilt shift lens. Outside of that concept, I wanted to come back to the idea of color. One thing that happens for me when I look at this image is, as much as I like all the color relationships, right now, if I feel for the color that is having the biggest impact on me, it's green. And overall, I get a real strong sense of green sort of being everywhere. And I feel like if we got some of the green out of this image, and that green became more of a place that you go to, there would be even more color depth and more vibrancy. It would let not only these color ideas come forward in the image, it would let the main idea come forward a little bit more down here. Right now, the concept of focus is competing with this as a main subject, and I feel like if some of the green recedes, that we can give this back a little bit more power in the image to be a focal point. There's so many different ways that we could go about doing this. One of the ways that I like to cut down on a color is to go into curves and use this eyedropper right here as almost a white balance tool. This is sample an image to set a gray point. I'm going to activate that dropper, and then if I look for an area like this that could be potentially neutral, but it has a good bit of the color that I want to cut down on in that area, I can click there. It's going to try to push that to gray. When it tries to get the green out of that area, it's going to cut down on green in the whole image. So I'm going to click right there, and in fact, it pushes me towards sort of the desired result. Now, in the composition, green is a color idea that I go to, but I don't feel like it's everywhere in the image. And to my eye, that is letting this main subject area down here come forward more. And it's cutting down on the feeling that I want those pieces of plant at the top to be sharp. Love to hear your feedback about that and see how this color change makes you feel about the image. The other thing that's really cool about this image from a color standpoint is because there's something about the subject matter that's so whimsical and the color is so outrageous to begin with. Let's just throw that layer away and then let's look at this. If we go to hue and we just move the hue slider, you have all these complementary color pairs, and now basically what we're just doing is changing the pairs of colors that complement each other. And to me, this would be a really fun image to, let's say, start here close to where Harriet shot it, and then maybe make a frame like this, maybe another frame like this, another frame that's something like this, and then put all those together on one canvas as a triptych, or maybe even more images, and frame them together. Might be a really fun presentation. Create a series of images where the color pairs just keep changing. And the potential for that is there because we started off with really wonderful color relationships to begin with. Last thing that I wanted to mention about this image is the idea of proportion and framing. 35 millimeter is a dramatic rectangle, and I think that that's really beautiful when we shoot 35 millimeter horizontally. As human beings, we're taught to read from left to right, and we scan our reality about 30 to 40 times a second between brain function and our eyes to build very complicated three-dimensional models in our brain of the spaces that we exist in. So we're trained in a lot of different ways to consider a panorama of information. And as nice as the long rectangle of 35 millimeter is if we shoot horizontal, when we go vertical, can really stop the mind's eye from being able to move on the x-axis. So we might not stay with the image as long. And one of the things that I do to a lot of my 35 millimeter verticals, particularly if it's a still life like this, or macro, or architecture, or landscape without people, something where if we change proportion and perspective, it might create a distraction. So much of the time, I will go into image, size, I will uncheck this box right here. I'm going to uncheck the constrained proportion, and I'll make the image wider if it's a vertical without changing the height. So let's say we go to 850 pixels, push this closer to 8.5 by 11 or 8 by 10. If I hit OK, and we'll see the image get wider without getting any taller. And to my mind's eye, I slow down more, and I'm able to move throughout the whole image in more of a pleasing way when it's closer to square than being so tall and skinny. I'd love to hear your feedback about that too. A stunning image from Harriet, just a really beautiful image that to me is about beautiful repetitions, really beautiful color relationships, really beautiful flow of focus from near to far, very whimsical, very inviting from a color standpoint. It's a stunning image. I want to say a big thank you to Harriet for sharing it with us. Hope to see you again real soon on another episode of The Daily Critique.